I am Mitchell Kaplan, and I'm the founder and president of Books & Books. My day is buying and selling books. That's my regular day. That's what I strive to do. And thirdly, in the doing of that, what I try to do is help create a sense of community. So we are very concerned, and I am very concerned, with working with our teams to present authors and programming here at the stores and serving the communities where all the different stores actually are. So all of my activities are geared toward that, whether I'm checking email, whether I'm speaking with the managers of the store, whether I'm meeting with sales reps and the buyer from Books & Books. All of those things go toward the events team. That's what my day consists of. I was an English major at the University of Colorado. I studied English Lit, and I took lots of different courses, lots of different survey courses. I took a course in 20th century Lit, and when I took that course as a freshman, I think that's where I got the first kernel of an idea of perhaps being in literary culture is something that I wanted to do. I took this course and I had discovered that at the center of most literary movements of the 20th century, there was a bookstore that was somewhat involved. You can imagine there's that famous Shakespeare and Company in Paris that Sylvia Beach owned and operated. She opened it in the teens during the 20th century. And it's the place where all the English language expats came, the American expats came, as well as the British expats after World War I. And they were known as kind of the lost generation. And her bookstore published Ulysses by James Joyce. You then move a little bit further on into the century in New York City, and there was a marvelous bookstore called the Gotham Book Mart. A woman named Frances Steloff owned that and operated that store. And she fought the real great censorship battles of that day. She was able to bring in D.H. Lawrence. She also started bringing in literary magazines from Europe in order to be able to present some of the great writing that was happening all over the world. And that happened in New York City. Then you get to the 50s and the Beats, and you know, Allen Ginsberg and Lawrence Ferlinghetti. In fact, Lawrence Ferlinghetti owned a bookstore there called City Lights in San Francisco, which is still in existence. The other two stores, well, Shakespeare and Company is still in existence in Paris, but it's gone through different ownership. But the Gotham Book Mart is no longer around. So I was an English major who had this kind of notion that literary culture was really, really important. But I kind of didn't know what to do with it. So when I graduated college, and in those days it was a very different kind of world in college, there were like 5,000 English majors and 300 business majors. The world has kind of shifted a little bit from then. And at the end of my college career, I sort of didn't know what I really wanted to do. And it was it wasn't necessarily following in my father's footsteps, but I was familiar with the law. And so I decided I'd give it a try, and I went to law school. And I went to law school for a couple of years, but that only reinforced my desire to get more involved in literary culture, whether in publishing or bookselling, I wasn't exactly sure. But when I was in law school in Washington, D.C., I found myself going into the bookstores more than I was in the law libraries, and they had some phenomenal bookstores. And Boulder, where I went to college, had some phenomenal bookstores as well. And then, as I was becoming more dissatisfied with the prospect of being a lawyer, I started focusing on what it was I really thought I wanted to do, and the notion of a bookstore just kept bubbling up. And so I left law school, came back to Miami, and didn't think I'd stay here, but I knew that I had to earn a living. So I went to University of Miami and got my master's degree in English and in education. And I taught high school. And I taught at Miami Southridge High School, which was a young high school at the time. And it was then that I started telling myself, well, let's step back. When I was in graduate school at UM, I really decided I was going to want to open a bookstore. So I took a part-time job in a bookstore while I was in graduate school to learn about the business of bookselling. And when I got hired to teach, I remember telling the woman who hired me that I wasn't going to be around that long because I was hoping to make my jump into opening a bookstore. And at that time, it was a kind of golden age of independent bookselling. There were thousands of English majors like me who didn't know what to do, so they opened up bookstores. And I'm only being partially facetious when I say that. In the early 80s, over 50% of all books sold were sold through independent bookstores. Remember, this is before the internet, before the big chains. The only chains that really existed at that time were the chains in the malls. There weren't the superstores. So most urban areas had really solid independent bookstores. In fact, Miami had a lot of them. But I decided that I would open up a bookstore here in Coral Gables. It was the very first one that we did. And I told myself that if I could pay myself the same amount that I was getting as a teacher, then I would make the permanent move into the bookstore side of things. And fortunately or unfortunately, the teacher's salary was so little at that point that the bar was not a very high bar to reach. So I opened up the very first Books and Books in Coral Gables in 1982, in the spring and in the fall. And over that summer, I gave up teaching, and in the fall, I was a full-time bookseller.